Welcome back to BOGO Biology. In this video, we'll be covering lactic acid fermentation, alcoholic fermentation, and anaerobic respiration, then comparing each of them to regular aerobic respiration. We'll cover the location, examples, the steps, reagents, products, and more. We'll be keeping track of most of this information in a diagram that looks like this, and also in a table that looks like this. Okay, here we go. To begin, let's go over some definitions. Respiration is the process that breaks down glucose or other sugars to form a larger amount of ATP by using an electron transport chain. There are two varieties, aerobic, if oxygen is available, and anaerobic, in which oxygen is not available. Fermentation is a separate process that breaks down glucose or other sugars to form a limited amount of ATP without the use of an electron transport chain. It produces an end product such as lactic acid or ethanol. Fermentation occurs when there is no oxygen or limited oxygen. Some organisms are obligate aerobes. They can only live in the presence of oxygen. Others are obligate anaerobes who can only live in environments with no oxygen. And some, like yeast, are facultative anaerobes. They can live in either type of environment and switch the process they use depending on the availability of oxygen. As we begin comparing, remember that the goal of any of these processes is to recharge some ATP. ATP is necessary for many, many cellular processes. Standard aerobic cellular respiration, the most common and most efficient strategy, consists of three phases: glycolysis, which occurs in the cytoplasm, then the Krebs cycle, which occurs in the mitochondria, and then the electron transport chain, which also occurs in the mitochondria. Glycolysis and the Krebs cycle each recharge a small amount of ATP via a process called substrate level phosphorylation. But the electron transport chain generates a huge amount via oxidative phosphorylation, making aerobic respiration a very powerful process. Oxidative phosphorylation is a more indirect process involving the buildup of a chemical gradient that is harnessed to recharge ATP. The downside of aerobic respiration is that it requires a steady input of oxygen as a final electron acceptor in order to run the electron transport chain and recharge the ATP. The oxygen has to suck up the electrons that come out of the end of the chain, keeping the electrons flowing, the proton pumps going, and the ATP synthase protein working. Without oxygen, the electron transport chain will become clogged and everything will stop functioning. Luckily, lactic acid fermentation, alcoholic fermentation, and anaerobic respiration can allow cells to recharge small amounts of ATP without needing any oxygen. This makes it a very useful process under certain circumstances. All four of these processes begin with the same set of reactions, glycolysis. In summary, glycolysis involves breaking down one molecule of glucose to eventually form two molecules of something called pyruvate. Pyruvate is a very versatile molecule. It can be used in aerobic respiration, lactic acid fermentation, alcoholic fermentation, and anaerobic respiration. Let's zoom in on the process of glycolysis a bit more. Glycolysis is split into two phases: the energy investment phase and the energy payoff phase. In the investment phase, we spend 2 ATP in order to strategically break apart 1 6-carbon molecule of glucose. Over the course of a few reactions, a long unstable molecule called fructose 1,6-bisphosphate is formed, which then breaks into two compounds, G3P and DHAP. The 3-carbon molecule G3P, or glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, is a very important molecule in biology. However, it has a ton of different names that vary from source to source and from country to country. You might know G3P as GA3P, GADP, GAP, TP, GALP, or PGAL. They all refer to the same molecule. Notice how the G3P is a direct part of the glycolysis pathway, but the DHAP is not. DHAP is useful in other biological processes, but in this case, in order to use its carbons for glycolysis, enzymes have to convert it into G3P first. So now instead of one molecule of G3P and one molecule of DHAP, we have two useful molecules of G3P. In the payoff phase of glycolysis, the 3-carbon G3P are converted into 2 3-carbon molecules of pyruvate. This series of reactions recharges 4 molecules of ATP, which gives us an overall net yield of 2 ATP. Remember, we invested 2 and then we created 4. This second series of reactions also generates waste products of protons and electrons. The molecule that specializes in clearing up these particles is a mobile electron carrier called nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide, or NAD. The NAD plus version of this molecule picks up a proton and two electrons and delivers them to wherever they're needed, often the electron transport chain in aerobic respiration. Then it comes back for more, a lot like a dump truck. As always, major shout out to my former students who originally cooked up this NA dump truck analogy. After it's picked up a proton and two electrons, we say that NAD plus has been reduced into NADH. In regular aerobic respiration, the NADH delivers the proton and two electrons to the electron transport chain where they're needed, and is thereby oxidized back into NAD+. The terms oxidation and reduction can be confusing, so remember, oil rig. Oxidation is losing and reduction is gaining. In summary, in aerobic respiration, glycolysis prepares some of the reagents that the electron transport needs, and then the electron transport chain prepares some of the reagents that glycolysis needs. But what about in fermentation reactions where there is no electron transport chain that needs the protons and electrons? We'd still need a steady supply of NAD+ in order to keep picking up the waste products, so we need to find a way to generate it. Fermentation adds an additional set of reactions that regenerate NAD+ so that glycolysis can continue. Fermentation reactions use enzymes to convert NADH back into NAD+, and this involves NADH losing electrons, so it's an oxidation reaction. Fermentation allows glycolysis to keep repeating and popping out 2 ATP each time. There are two common fermentation pathways, lactic acid fermentation and alcohol fermentation. Both of them involve oxidizing NADH back into the NAD+ that glycolysis needs. Both lactic acid and alcoholic fermentation take place in the cytoplasm. Lactic acid fermentation occurs in the bacteria that are used to make yogurt and also in our own muscle cells. This is probably good because if our muscles made alcohol instead of lactic acid, working out would make us drunk and then likely kill us via alcohol poisoning. Alcohol fermentation occurs in yeast cells, and this process is harnessed to make bread, beer, wine, and other alcohol products. Let's look at each fermentation pathway a bit more closely, starting with lactic acid fermentation. Lactic acid fermentation begins with glycolysis, where glucose is ultimately converted into pyruvate, recharging a net amount of 2 ATP and reducing 2 NAD+ into 2 NADH. The 3-carbon pyruvate molecule combines with the electrons and the protons from NADH and forms 3-carbon lactic acid. Because the pyruvate picks up the electrons, it's considered to be the final electron acceptor in lactic acid fermentation. Notice how the production of lactic acid oxidizes NADH back into NAD+ that we need in order to keep running glycolysis and churning out 2 ATP each time. The production of lactic acid is what gives yogurt its tangy flavor, and it's also what makes vigorous exercise hurt so much. Muscle cells perform lactic acid fermentation when the breakdown of sugars exceeds the supply of oxygen being delivered by the blood, making aerobic respiration no longer feasible. The cells are still able to make some ATP, but now they have to use this less efficient and far more painful process of lactic acid fermentation. Lactate, the ionized form of lactic acid, is eventually carried to the liver and the blood. There it is converted back into pyruvate and then into glucose via a process called the Cori cycle. The newly formed glucose can then be fed back into glycolysis. However, because this conversion back to glucose depletes 6 ATP and lactic acid fermentation only recharges 2 ATP, the process cannot be sustained indefinitely. Eventually, you can't sustain the level of effort anymore and you have to either slow down or stop. Alcoholic fermentation is another method for regenerating the NAD+ needed to keep glycolysis going. In alcohol fermentation, the pyruvate from glycolysis is first converted into an intermediate compound called acetaldehyde. In the second step, the two NADH molecules each lose 2 electrons and a proton, which combine with the acetaldehyde to form a type of alcohol called ethanol. Because the acetaldehyde accepts the electrons, it's considered to be the final electron acceptor in alcoholic fermentation, and NADH is oxidized back into NAD+. Notice how pyruvate had 3 carbons, but acetaldehyde and ethanol only have 2 carbons. The extra carbon hasn't magically disappeared. It's released in the form of carbon dioxide during the first step of alcoholic fermentation. This formation of carbon dioxide gas gives beer and champagne their fizzy bubbles and is also what causes bread to rise. Finally, let's talk about anaerobic respiration. It's important to note that this is a different process than lactic acid fermentation or alcohol fermentation, even though all of them are anaerobic processes. Respiration, either aerobic or anaerobic, involves the use of an electrochemical gradient across a membrane to regenerate ATP. They both take in glucose, use glycolysis, the Krebs cycle, and an electron transport chain. The difference is what acts as the final electron acceptor at the end of the electron transport chain. Aerobic respiration uses oxygen, but organisms that do anaerobic respiration live in anoxic environments, so no oxygen is available. Instead, they use other substances like sulfate, nitrate, or other electronegative compounds to scoop up the electrons that pop out of the end of the electron transport chain. Organisms that have to perform anaerobic respiration are called obligate anaerobes and include the bacteria found in soil. However, sulfate and nitrate and their peers are less electronegative than oxygen. They don't attract electrons as strongly. This makes the process less efficient than aerobic respiration. The exact amount of ATP this process yields is unknown as of the time I'm making this video, but it's thought to be a bit less than the standard 36 to 38 recharged ATP from aerobic respiration. So in summary, there are four main strategies for recharging ATP: aerobic respiration, lactic acid fermentation, alcohol fermentation, and anaerobic respiration. Here are all four processes side by side. Notice how each of them involves the process of glycolysis and also a set of reactions later on that allow for the oxidation of NADH. In aerobic respiration, the process takes place in the cytoplasm and the mitochondria and is performed by most cells and sometimes also by yeast. It requires the input of glucose and oxygen, its steps are glycolysis, the Krebs cycle, and the electron transport chain, and it involves both substrate level and oxidative phosphorylation. Oxygen acts as the final electron acceptor, and it produces 36 to 38 ATP as well as some CO2. Lactic acid fermentation occurs in the cytoplasm. It's performed by muscle cells and the bacteria in yogurt. It requires the input of glucose, but no oxygen. And its steps involve glycolysis and a fermentation pathway. It conducts only substrate-level phosphorylation, with pyruvate serving as the final electron acceptor, and it produces a net yield of 2 ATP as well as lactic acid. Alcohol fermentation occurs in the cytoplasm. It's performed by yeast. It requires the input of glucose, but again, no oxygen, and its steps involve glycolysis and the fermentation pathway. It only conducts substrate-level phosphorylation with acetaldehyde serving as the final electron acceptor. It produces a net yield of 2 ATP as well as a form of alcohol called ethanol. Anaerobic respiration takes place in the cytoplasm and the mitochondria. It's performed by bacteria and archaea in environments that have little to no oxygen, and it requires the input of glucose and a final electron acceptor such as sulfate or nitrate. Its steps involve glycolysis, the Krebs cycle, and the electron transport chain, and it involves both substrate level and oxidative phosphorylation. The sulfate, nitrate, or other electronegative compound serves as the final electron acceptor, and the process produces slightly less than the 36 to 38 ATP that we expect from aerobic respiration. This mechanism is pretty uncommon compared to the others and is not as well understood. That wraps up our discussion of respiration and fermentation. If you found this video useful, I hope you'll consider subscribing to my channel and checking out some of my other videos. Thanks so much again for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye!